automatically springs open. There is a tissue shortage and it is open.
I was talking about the principle
as far as personally what one does is a different thing. When we are talking to younger group, we should talk of the principle.
Yes, I would agree with Karun. When we say that do we need to do anything extra to lengthen the nasal mucosa, then the answer is that if you have done freed the nasal mucosa and the muscles from the posterior border of the heart palate and the edges of the cleft, it should provide you enough lengthening. However, if you feel that it is short, then you should do something to lengthen it. But I think what Dr. Reddy was saying, that we as plastic surgeons should not leave straight scars. So there is no harm in incorporating a Z-plasty with the sole purpose of breaking the scar and having a bonus of slight lengthening also. So I think we will leave it to the judgment. Sir, you want to say something before I conclude?
You know, I've been wondering that this muscle has been in an abnormal position for about 9 months intra-utero. Then at least 6 months extra-utero. When a soft tissue like that has been remaining in an abnormal position, does it not undergo secondary contracture? And it should undergo secondary contracture.
Food for thoughts, we don't know.
You know, I will tell you what. In a contracture elbow, you release the skin, but cannot release the tendon, and it comes slowly. So if this is secondarily contracted, and particularly the tensor muscle, which is really not muscle, but it is more fibrous tissue. And I think we cannot estimate the amount of secondary contracture that is present. That's why we get uneven results. You know, one more minute I'll take. In all methods of cleft palate repair, according to a very recent textbook, 65% to 70% of the patients get intelligible speech without speech therapy in all methods of repair. So therefore there is something imponderable. I can understand when Mukund says that, you know, there is secondary contracture and therefore he goes and does a furlough. But I don't know whether I would like to put a Z-plasty to start with when I know that that is the statistics that is in front of me when I'm writing this new chapter now. Are they going to get normal speech or intelligible speech? So therefore I don't know. There are people who just cut the nasal mucosa and do a one layer closure, which also works sometimes. I mean, you don't have to put a buccal clap there, because if there is a hole, then it possibly cannot contract. And I can tell you from my personal experience, I've cut across the nasal layer, got a good solid mucoperiosteal closure at the junction of the heart and soft palate, and it does not necessarily break down.
Right, sir. Well, like many things in cleft lip and palate, this controversy probably is not very difficult to resolve. Okay. Now, you have operated on a patient of cleft palate and patient is in the recovery room. So, what should be your concern when you go to examine this patient, say, soon after he has been shifted to the recovery room?
Bleeding and respiratory distress. Bleeding?
Bleeding, you look for the bleeding.
Respiratory distress.
No, first is, will you look at the position of the patient, whether the patient is lying in the right position? So what should be the position of the patient on the bed?
Left.
Lateral.
Left lateral. Left lateral or right lateral?
Any lateral.
Okay. And you will look for bleeding. Okay. So when you shift the patient to the ward and in the evening you have gone for the rounds. So what will you see? Next one.
Means the bleeding and respiratory distress. Same thing.
Respiratory distress, how would you check?
Patient.
Ask the patient, are you having distress?
Gasping or...
that will be the end stage. So, can you take up some very simple investigation tool which can help you that the patient is having respiratory distress or he is having some respiratory compromise?
Speech?
Huh?
Speech?
Pulse oximetry.
Pulse oximetry. That probe is there, look at the saturation. Okay. Next day in the ward, what will you look at the patient?
No, I think
next one.
Okay. On the first day, we have to think of three things in post-operative period. One is the breathing, second is the bleeding, and third is the feeding.
these three are important aspects on the first post-operative day.
But Karun, I'll come to the feeding part in my next slide.
Yes.
Okay.
Because we are talking of going to the ward next day.
Okay. So next day.
If any packs have been given in the lateral, so they should be removed.
So if you have kept the packs in the lateral space, you want to have a look at that. And
tongue
stitch. So do you all keep the tongue stitch regularly in the post-operative period in all your patients?
If the patient is of a Peyer-Ogden syndrome type of patient, I mean
non-syndromic left palate, uneventful.
And if you feel that the lengthening is much more and there is hot table, you'll find that there is a lot of.
So you like to keep the tongue stitch.
Anticipate the respiratory distress. Then
but
I would like to put in a nasopharyngeal airway, fix it with the tape, and I take one time tongue stitch. And we remove the tongue stitch in the evening by the time he is patient
about 6-7 hours
completely recovered. Nasal airway, if patient tolerates, we'll keep it overnight. Otherwise, we remove in the evening itself.
To the PGs, the aspect in this is normally the examiners expect you to follow what is taught in your unit.
Yes.
And not to imagine something. In the, in your unit, you don't keep a tongue stitch as a routine. You just say, I don't keep. Same thing about throat pack, post-op monitoring, what have you, or your marking of the flap, and what type of method you use. If you feel your unit, they are doing a triangular flap, but you believe as a person that Nilaj is better, but you have to stick to the triangular flap.
Yes,
that is what
politically correct also.
Because if you run into your trouble, then your professor will help you. Because you are following what he is doing. This I have seen in any number of exams.
Yes, sir, you are right. You are absolutely right.
People try to guess what the examiner expects you to say. Examiner is trying to find out what you
have learnt over the
period. Yes.
Yes.
How can you can defend your position? That's what we are looking at.
Yes, sir.
So if you are trying to imagine what the examiner expects you to say, you'll be in soup.
Nobody has been able to imagine that.
It's the same thing about it is because you have seen that the straight line closure, four of us have different opinions. So same thing, all the examiners will have different opinions.
Yes.
But they will support you. And your professor will support you in case you are saying the same thing which you have been taught or you have been doing in your department. So you have to stick with that irrespective. Not only clear, any operations or any approach to any patient. And as far as tongue stitch, our own protocols differ. For example, Dr. Adenwala, one of the senior most classic surgeons, the routine puts a tongue stitch in every case. Whereas Nitin and me and many of us would put it in case we have a doubt.
Right.
Or if the anesthetist has a doubt, then we would put it. There is no harm in putting it. But then if a last 850 cases, I put tongue stitch in 2 cases in my unit. So I don't want to subject the other, how many? 848 patients to a tongue stitch without any valid reason.
Right, sir. So, as he very rightly said, it's very difficult to read the examiner's mind. Examiner's mind is like woman's mind, nobody can know. So, sustained. Okay, all right. Objection sustained. Okay. So, what do you see when the patient comes to you for follow up in the OPD after, say, about a week or 10 days and then at 3 months?
Maintenance of oral hygiene.
On first week, you will look at the oral hygiene.
Suture.
And?
Suture lines.
And? Suture line. Okay. And at 3 months?
Speech.
Velopharyngeal closure, speech. Okay. You want to add anything to that?
Nasal regurgitation. Still the patient is having nasal regurgitation or not. At least you ask him, after surgery, what has been the result?
You know, when we were residents in PGI in early 80s, that time all patients of cleft lip and palate would have their hands restrained. We used to give them, splints made up of either plaster of Paris or cut out of the plastic bottles. they used to have those Logan bows applied on their lips. So in majority of the units now people feel that there is no need for any hand restraint and there is no need to put any protective appliance onto the repaired lip. Your views on that?
We also stopped using hand restraints or packs which are removable long way back. I do put Sergicel small one in a in this rye. If there are some rye areas, I would put Sergicel rather than put a pack. Restraints are only if the anesthetist IV line secured. For securing the IV line, they would put a smaller one across the wrist. That's all restraint that we use. Again, it boils down to what you use in the department where you work. So you have to stick with that.
Yes.
I don't use restraint for past 20 years, I have not used regularly, but there are children who definitely require restraint because of the parents. And second is the thumb sucking. If the child is having preoperatively thumb sucking habit, probably these are the children where one should use. Second, the parents, some of the concerned parents, they are not very happy if the child is having the free hands. In those cases, you can use for a week or 10 days. But I'll tell you the literature. I was very surprised. 2012, there is an international study on the use of hand restraint. And published data from USA says 65% of the centers are using the hand restraint for first 10 days of the surgery. We did similar study in 2009. Gopal Krishna and we published the status of cleft care in India. You'll be surprised to know that 85% of the surgeons who participated in the study, 192 surgeons participated and 85% of them were using hand restraint. This is 2009. And 2012 study is US.
Very interesting.
So it is not obsolete.
So, how early can we start the feeding in case of cleft lip and in case of cleft palate? Yes, Pradesh.
6 hours.
6 hours. In cleft lip also?
Yes.
So, this will be breastfeeding or the spoon feeding?
Cut to the spoon feeding.
So, can we start the breastfeeding if the mother says that this child who had cleft lip operated is used to breastfeeding? So, can I breastfeed the child? What will be your answer?
No, sir.
No. Anybody who says yes? Yes, Nitin.
I think with the cleft lip patient, they can have a breastfeeding. No issue.
They can have breastfeeding.
Because we are taking good care, we are taking good muscle layers, sutures, all the layers are very well sutured. In fact, breastfeeding improves the edema. Because of the sucking, all the edema disappears. And child is much more comfortable with the breastfeeding. No crying, nothing.
Yes. There was an interesting study from Srinagar in Kashmir, wherein they had, Dr. Mohammad Darzi had done this study. And they were starting the breastfeeding in the child as soon as the child recovered in the recovery room itself. They found that not only that the crying in the child was less, there was no deleterious effect on the repair. So I think we can start the breastfeeding provided the child is ready for that.
Even the bottle feeding also?
No, but I am concerned about the milk feed given too early in these children. Especially when children are operated little late in the daytime. So the 6 hours will finish by 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock in midnight because my children centers, they are operating till 8 o'clock, the fresh cases, small children. And invariably, whatever complications have been seen,
at that time only.
At that time it happens.
Okay.
Because the care, post-operative care, nursing care is in every hospital, corporate, private or government hospital. It is quite deficient in midnight because everybody is falls asleep between 10 to 5 o'clock in the morning. So one should always be careful about giving a milk feed in late in evening or late in night because that will curdle and if vomiting is there, it is likely to cause aspiration. So most of the centers they follow is the plain water feeding in the evening time and night time and milk is to be started next hour.
Dr. Mukunda, anything different?
No. Protocols differ again from place to place.
Yes.
Usually the protocol is evolved with the
experience of the unit.
Experience of the unit and with the concurrence of the anesthetist. In our, the post-op ICU and the recovery is under care of the anesthetist. Our protocol is 2 hours they give a sip of
water
fluids, usually
yes.
water.
Yes, sir.
4 hours they, if the child is awake, then they would start with
milk. Right.
And we never operate till evening or night. So
that luxury we don't
children, have. Children are finished. We operate. Children are usually done fasting in the morning.
Morning.
So 12 or 1 o'clock is the maximum beyond which we don't take children.
Sir, I just wanted to say one thing. I visited Dr. Guleria in somewhere in 96 and I saw that as soon as the patient was out and he will start feeding the child. And since that time, I have followed that myself. My instructions are start oral feeding as soon as the child is fully awake. And I think that what is important is what kind of anesthetic agent has been used actually. Nowadays they are using sevoflurane and with that I think you can start feeding very early.
That is
what we are doing and we don't have any problem. My orders are that as soon as the child is fully awake, child can be started to
actually,
feed.
Actually, I would agree with you because majority of the patients who are given early feeding, they don't cry much. I think one of the reasons for the children crying post-operative period is that they are hungry. So I think it's an important point that we should start these children on feeding as per the permissible early time in your unit.
Ramesh, I wanted to ask you, how many cleft lips receive infraorbital blocks with sensor pain or local infiltration, because that completely relieves the pain?
Yeah.
Whenever I have given an intraorbital block,
I think many units
really
practice at the end of the surgery, they will inject some kind of long-acting
and the big difference is that when the child wakes up, it wakes up as if it is woken up from sleep. Under those circumstances, breastfeeding is definitely allowed.
Right, sir. Patamana, you want to say something?
Was just you know, putting my chip that if the patient can breastfeed, especially lip patient, I mean, there's no harm. Because it's an active process and the child would take breastfeeds only when the child has woken up enough and there is no harm in early breastfeeding.
When can we start bottle feeding, say,
in
parent patients or in lip patients?
That is a usual question.
I will address that question to the panel.
The first part is about feeding. When do you give? Depends on your comfort level. It depends. You have to have faith in your anesthetist. And anesthetist, if you force them to give early, they are not happy. Because again, not and finishing off what we have started.
Right.
And it also depends on how the surgeon feels. My teacher, Professor Prasad, he was happy to see the child cry. He said, let the child cry for 1 hour, then the lungs will be nicely aerated. And after that, we'll start feeding. So he said, he will tell the parent in front of me, if the child is not crying, please tell me. So we are worried if the child is not crying.
You have to pinch the child and then
yes,
it start crying.
Something like that. Bottle feed, nowadays with silicone bottles and all that,
soft
it depends
bottle,
on what
soft
type bottles. Of, if it's soft palate and part of the hot palate, I would start immediately.
Right,
if it's a complete cleft, I would say 10 days to 15 days. No bottle feed. For a complete cleft.
And when do we start with the semi-solids?
See, normally we operate at 9 months. The semi-solid, which is
Cerulac,
only Cerulac. Or we start immediately with diluted Cerulac.
Right.
I prefer not to allow bottle, not to promote bottle feeding in our children. And I always tell, now it is 6 months, 7 months, 8 months time when we are doing palate operated, better to give cup. Straight cup and spoon, because the kind of patients we get, it is very difficult for them to maintain the hygiene of the bottle. So well, it's better to give the cup and spoon.
Say, and your patients agree? Their patients agree?
Yeah, of course.
Very
all
obedient
of,
parents.
All of them
very, very
shift over because once the surgeon says something, they will follow. If you have this proper counseling with the, especially the surgeons, if the
right.
surgeon says, if you put your right hand on the left ear, they will keep it.
Very lucky.
The second thing is about the semi-solid. We prefer to give semi-solid after 2 weeks. And if the child has to take solid, can be, I allow them anywhere after 2 weeks, anytime they are
asking. To add to that, we are talking about 9 months old babies. If the child is 5 years old, I would start semi-solid within 48 hours. It has to be 48
hours. 48 hours.
48.
Thank you.
I wanted to know why you were asking about the bottle feed. Did you have an experience where there were sutures broken because somebody...
I don't start actually.
But I sometimes feel that I'm probably being overprotective. I don't start the bottle
feed. I also feel even 10 days, 15 days, maybe we are overprotective.
Yeah.
So why not? Only thing is, so far I have never had a single patient come back with broken palate. Because the parents have fed beforehand, for whatever reason, thumb sucking, what have you, nothing, not even one kid.
Bottle feeding, this the mother will ask, can I feed the child with the bottle? If you say yes, she will say, are you sure? That's a very common, are you sure, otherwise I will not give. So I said, why did you ask in the first place?
Dr. Thomas, you want to say something about the feeding part?
Varsar, I always ask the mother that the way she is feeling preoperatively, she must feed the baby postoperatively. If she is feeding by bottle, I ask the mother to feed the by bottle.
And you had no problems?
No problems.
So Dr. Thomas, your views on this?
After hearing all these things, I would like to add, safety of the operation is the most important. And where you are practicing, you should adopt the protocols.
Right.
When I went to Oman, I will say, the most illiterate, that is way back in 1981, mm-hmm. very uneducated group, and the people are coming far off, even 1,500 kilos just far away. Mm-hmm. I don't want a single mortality or morbidity. That will finish the plastic surgery in Oman. So, I have taken all the precautions in which the operation should be successful. So, I adopted everything, I will tell you. All the hand restraints and that packing. Everything I tell you should go all right. And I used to keep the cases up to even stitches are out, then only I will discharge the patient. Mundu was there, that was the protocol. We want the safety of the precaution and the people should have the belief and the trust. And when I went as a guest surgeon in Operation Smile in China, that is in a remote village, the leader of the Operation Smile mentioned, don't do the operation below the, there are so many children are there, don't do any operation below the age of 1 year. I said, why? We don't want any mortality here. If there's one mortality is here, our whole program will be completely upset. So, what I am telling about, these are all fine. Where you are practicing, your protocols, your patients are educated, they will be very happy to what you say, they will adopt. But if you are practicing, the society in which you need to adopt protocols in which the safety of the operation will be the paramount importance.
Yes, I think this point is very well taken and you have to adopt to your own things. Well, as I told you, there is a paper in the delegate kit where you are supposed to do the lip markings of the operation of your choice and kindly give it to the registration counter. We will try to evaluate how many of you have done it correctly. Please note down your name and your registration number there. We'll try to get back to you. I thank all the delegates and the panel for this interesting interactive session. Thank you very much.
Uncle bol do yaar hum bhi baithe hain.